This club was founded in 2019 in November. It's a national NPO for all South African men and boys, or should I say every man and boy living in the Republic of South Africa and who subscribe to the constitution of the Republic of this land, and also who pays their sole allegiance to this country. So we see you as well as our host as an eligible member of the club, and it is people like you who will help this movement of developing our country and moving forward, particularly from the base of communities, our homes, moving forward. This club was founded on the five founding pillars, which are aimed at addressing the psychosocial and economic issues. We don't subscribe to any political house. We never intend to belong to any. We intend to address issues that talks to our communities, that talks to developing a man and a boy child as leaders. Our philosophy derives from the Bible, where God has founded the first institution in life. Was never a church, was never a political house or a parliament, but it was a family. So leadership, we believe at Saljek that any leadership begins in the family. If you want to see what kind of a family we having as a society, look at the leaders that you have. They will tell you what kind of families do you have. If we have dysfunctional leaders in any institutions around, clearly it will tell you that the foundation of leadership in the families is replicated from what we see outside. So we need to build leaders, and we need to build them from the home. And it is for that reason that this club has requested you, leadership, to come and give us a lecture on the topic of reconciliation and forgiveness, because these are key issues that are very important foundations of building a family. If you can't forgive, if you can't reconcile, it becomes difficult as families, and we're drifting apart every day and all the time. When we came to this topic, there were a lot of objections. People were saying, why do you discuss such a critical topic on Valentine's Day? Why don't you have someone come and talk to us about love matters? But we believed strongly that these issues fits nicely into this culture of Valentine's and whatever, because truly it's a matter of love. If we are going to build a family and a family structure, you need to take every opportunity around to ensure that you build that into that structure so that we move forward as a whole. Love doesn't only apply to your partner that you're dating or going to the movie with. Love also includes family and family members. That is why it is important that as men, we look at lineage. Where is our lineage? And try and connect with our lost lineage, because if you look at it, we have lost our lineage for many reasons, many years apart, to a point where we are, we don't even know if we're going or coming. You cannot lose your lineage as a man. Try and find a lineage if there's an opportunity. Try and learn forgive. In the Bible, there's a verse that talks about, God says, I shall give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Not for the kingdom of heaven, to the kingdom of heaven. And the purpose for those keys, it goes on and says, one of the keys is what is locked on earth will also be locked in heaven. And furthermore, the same sentence, it also talks about if you forgive on earth, on heaven also, the key to open heaven is you will be forgiven. So forgiveness is very critical and is very crucial at the foundation level. Because if we've learned to forgive and reconcile now, we are literally opening heaven for ourselves. We're opening access to the blessings that comes from heaven. And this is why this pillar this request for this topic was brought. So in Saljek, we're hosting men as the owners of this platform. And we also have hosting boy child. So every man across all ages of this country, social class or anything, they come to Saljek for various reasons to build our communities and our societies. We cannot be coming as brilliant individuals who live in suburbs, in cities, in big houses, and so much successful, running huge organizations, running corporates, CEOs, CFOs, and all these things. But we fail to plow back to our communities. It is unheard of, and it's very unacceptable. So in SALJAC, we are saying every man come to the club, contribute as much as you can to build your community and society. Because a young man that you grab on the street and you mentor is a man who's going to be a man tomorrow and bring safety, security to your family as well. So let's not look at the individualistic type of people that we have been cultured to be, that only me and me and me. Questions come and they ask about what about women, because you are the gentleman's club. With women, Chris, with women, we call these people our friends, because there's no society, a righteous society, let me put it that way. There is no righteous society that doesn't have women in it. God made a man. After making a man, he made a helper, a partner, a friend, and that was a woman. So we believe that women are friends of the club, and women are welcomed in the club. Hence, we created a desk of friends of the club, Friends of SALJAC, which is women who support our programs that are community-based. So if there's any women who have just joined us in this lecture, I want to welcome you and tell you that we have arrived in the right place. We know you have raised us most of the time as single mothers when our fathers were not there for various reasons. We know we still have mothers and sisters and whatever who raise single children now, who raise children now as single parents. And sometimes we are overwhelmed on how to raise these boys when there's no fathers. This club, it's also for people like yourself. We're creating programs that we think and we wish you would participate in them to ensure that these boys are getting accommodated. And recently we have created, out of the National Essay Competition, we have created the ambassadors of the youth ambassadors in the club. So these are young men across all provinces of this country who are members of the club, and they're encouraging other boys in schools, in social gatherings, to change their behaviors and be part of the club. So when you talk about programs, we've got just a few programs that I can mention to you. We have recently a national youth essay writing competition where boys across the country were writing essays on the topic of toxic masculinity. The purpose is to be educative to these boys, for them to learn that how is toxicity affecting the community, the society, even their partners as they are, because you'd agree with me that bullying in schools has grown to high numbers. Bullying in the streets, our daughters get bullied by boys who don't even know what they're doing. Eventually they kill them and they throw them in dustbins, or they burn them because they're scared now. How did they get themselves in that situation? So that program, it was in its founding year last year. So it's a program that will be running every year perpetually to try and educate the youth and the boys across the country. We have other new program that we have launched. They call it Lewala Banna, which is basically the cave for men, where men go sit, they normally sit and they talk about issues that are related to men, legislative issues that affect fathers who are unable to have access to their children, and all those things. So men should gather together within Lewala Banna and discuss these matters and find the information. This club says, we are there for you men, share information and all that. And we do not believe that men are crap, as has been said outside. Hence our issues are social, our founding pillars talk psychosocial and economic. We are bringing men together. What is the challenge? What is the problem? How can we help? How can we help each other? So we are addressing issues of economy, issues of emotions, issues of psych. So this is what we are. So in a nutshell, this is what this club is all about, Leadership Chris. Lord, are you telling me that I'm out?
You're still on. You're still on. Carry on.
Oh, I'm still on. Oh, yes, okay. Yeah, okay. Sorry about that. I thought it kicked me out. So this lab, I can go on and talk about it because my passion for it is just beyond measure. But today, as I always say, it's not about me. Today it's about our Chris Denga, who's going to take us through the topic of the topic of forgiveness and reconciliation in our communities. Because this is a very emotional issue. Most people have got issues with forgiveness, and I'm sure that lots of us here are going to be listening attentively. And I advise everyone to take a notepad, put the notes down as he's going along, because just after his presentation, we'll be having a lot of questions and comments. But right now, what I want to do, I want to go quickly and introduce him to everyone. My system is very slow here. I want to introduce him by reading his bio.
I think, Bo, leadership, Bo, that, just to assist you a bit with your network, just switch off your video and only do your voice. Switch off your video, it will be better.
Yeah. Okay, let me switch off my video. Right, I've got it. Switch off. Yeah. So I wasn't aware that there's an issue with the network. So I'm trying to get to the bio. The network is very slow now, I realize also. But let me try and see if I can. I don't know if there's any leader that side who's got access to your bio who can help us quickly. So as I'm going to search for the bio of leadership, Chris, I need everyone to just be ready. Take the notepads. Yeah, I'm here. Take the notepads and be ready to take notes, because there's going to be a lot that's spoken about, and we're going to share a lot of information with you. So his biography, it's not much. I've asked it that he just make it very precise so that we all get it. So Christopher Denga was born in Tembisa on the East Rand in Ekurhuleni. He is currently residing in Kempton Park. He completed his high school in Tembisa High School. He completed a diploma in financial management and also completed a certificate in ministry from Team Impact University. He was in the corporate world for more than 35 years. So he's got 35 years of experience. The last 10 years, in the capacity of regional sales manager in the pharmaceutical industry. He left the industry in March 2020 last year to focus on prison ministry after being appointed as an executive director of Prison Fellowship South Africa, also known as found by Grace, SNPC, that pretends prison programs in South Africa. South African Correctional Centers. One of the programs, Sycamore Tree Project, Justice and Peace, in a restorative justice program that focuses on offenders taking responsibility for their actions and trying to repair the harm their criminal activities have done to the community. He's also a chairman of the Evangelist Movement for Christ, EMC, which caters for ex-inmates reintegration in the community they once wronged. He enjoys going to the gym, keep fit. He has completed 10 Comrades Marathons. Wow, that says a lot. And other ultra marathons around South Africa. He plays golf and cycles. He is a child of God who serves under the leadership of Pastor Christopher Matebula, Hope Restoration Ministry in Kempton Park. In a nutshell, that's the bio of our speaker today, ladies and gentlemen. And as I said, today it's not about me. I'm handing over to Chris to dwell into it. Leadership, it's time for you to jump into it.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the intro, Leadership Bo. It's a privilege and a pleasure for me to be invited. And also I decided, the issue of forgiveness, no matter how tough and difficult it is closest to my heart. but and this is evident with the fact that I have been doing prison ministry for the last 8 years in various centers around the country in South Africa. And as he has alluded before, can I just quickly share my screen? I think we can start rolling from it, will be much better.
Absolutely.
All right, can you see my screen? Is everything fine there?
On my side, just as Chris has started screen sharing. Yes, okay. Yes.
Okay, perfect. Right. So yeah, as I was saying, I mean, the issue of forgiveness is very, very clear. I mean, just as a personal testimony for myself is that, I received the Lord Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior in 2010 after the World Cup. And I think a week later, my son, who was then 16 years of age, was stabbed at school. And I quickly went to hospital to check on him. Thank God he was okay. And the stabbing was so bad that one of his lung, the lung on the left, was pierced. It was blood inside. So,
leadership, can we ask someone to mute there? There's so much noise. And it's distracting.
It's in the kitchen.
Oh, it's on your side.
No, it's not. Not on my side. I can hear the sound.
Yeah, someone please mute, please.
Right, and then the test happened there and there because, with these boys at high school, I mean, this young man was doing matric, and these boys were now talking about revenge attack, that one group from Tembisa and his group from Kempton Park. So something had to be done. So what I did was I went to Tembisa, to St. Pierre van Redefeld High School, spoke to the principal and requested him if I could address the students, and the request which he granted to me. And I went in there. Remember, I was just a 1 week old child of God. Right? The scriptures were not there. I was still a baby Christian. But you know what? The grace of the Lord, the grace and the mercy of the Lord was so great that I went in there and I spoke a mouthful. I spoke about forgiveness. And I can tell you from that moment, there was not even a single revenge attack that happened. But it didn't end up there. I went to this young man because I had opened a case of attempted murder at the police station. And I went to this young man. I told him that, you know what, my son, this is what I've done, but it's up to you now. Now you are okay. If you want to carry on and proceed with the case, it's up to you. But my advice from me would be to let go. I know you've been hurt. But it was difficult for him because he asked me one pertinent question. He said, "Dad, I hear what you are saying. You want me to withdraw the case. What if it was you who was stabbed? What if it is you who gets stabbed in the future by the same young man? What would happen?" Well, I said to him, "You know what, my son, it's up to you, entirely up to you. But I would forgive." So forgiveness was born from me from that moment going forward. Right. Now, let's look at what happens here with my presentation is that, with Prison Fellowship South Africa as an executive director, is that we do prison programs to rehabilitate offenders. As you know, offender rehabilitation is a societal responsibility. And everyone else has got to take part. And you know that those guys, no matter how much they have wronged the community, they still belong to the community. They are our brothers, they are our sisters. And they're gonna be coming back, right? And one of the programs that Bo has shared with you was Sycamore Tree Project, which is Justice and Peace. And this program is a restorative justice program geared towards victim offender dialogue and mediation. Because as you know that when somebody is eligible for parole, what happens is that they go through one of the programs where victim offender dialogue and mediation takes place because they need to come to a point where they have to take responsibility for their actions and not blame other things. And in the program, what we do also, we bring in and we introduce a surrogate victim so that the victim who is not directly involved with the crime that they have committed, but somebody who has been a victim of any other crime, and they can come in and share their experience. They share what the impact of the crime they have experienced before, during the time, and well after. And you know what? This is working, because this man eventually, you can see remorse in them, and they can really realize and see the damage they are causing onto the community they have wronged. And the end results is offenders wanting to meet with their victims and offer their apologies, right? And that leads to reparation of some sort, and which eventually forgiveness is achieved. And very often, and I've stressed it and I've said, very often reconciliation takes place. Because remember, forgiveness and reconciliation are not the same. They're completely different. And we'll unpack it as we continue with the slides. But I just want to say that we are a broken nation. And I want to steal from Honorable Maimane, where he went into parliament and he spoke about the broken nation. And I won't mention the other brokenness that he spoke about. But we are hurt, and we continue to hurt one another, right? So brokenness is a part of everyday life. It is, we live with it. And no one makes it through life avoiding it. You can never avoid being hurt by the one who loves you or the one whom you have trusted, a friend of yours. You can never avoid it. And it is part of the human experience, no matter who you are, every one of us. The world can break us. As we walk out of there, I mean, Jesus was saying, when in his prayer, he says, he would have loved to have the believers taken with him. But he says they want them to continue, because they should not be worried. He says, do not worry, right? You are going to be challenged a lot, but he has overcome the world. Right? And then I also say other people's action can break us as well. And as you can see, the truth is that we are broken from the past hurts, and there's no one who has lived in this earth and who continue to live on this earth that can tell us that they have never been hurt. Hearts have been broken in relationships, in business transactions, all over, in politics, everywhere. We get hurt, not because of our faults, but because we live in a broken world. We are in this world, that's why we are broken. And many times we are hurt by the very people we love and we trust, and we open up to a lot of people. And those are the people that many a time hurt us, and we've got a problem, right? We've all been on both sides of the coin. Some great to a greater degree than others, but we can all probably think at times where we also have hurt other people, because we are people, we are human. And we've definitely found ourselves as the victim of another person's wrongdoing all the time. So that happens, okay. Now, I looked at brokenness, and what brokenness does is that, broken people can crush other people. And it's true, when we are saying hurt people, hurt people. So those who are hurt and they've been hurt in the past have got the tendency to continue to hurt other people. Since we are all born with fractured and dark hearts, our intentions, our speech, our actions, we always divide, we separate, and we damage other people. And this is inherent in us as people. And we can only, you can only give what you possess. If you are hurt, that's all you have. That's all you've experienced. And you continue to hurt other people until you have been healed. Then you can offer healing to other people. So we always say that hurt people hurt other people. Now, brokenness, what does it do? It normally leads to separation. And as you can see, that plate is separated. It's broken. It is useless. It can never be used. No one can dish out food or a meal on it, because it's broken. It is damaged. Right. So the separation in there. And eventually what happens is that there is unforgiveness that happens. So brokenness leads to separation and ultimately to unforgiveness. Right. And then I've said there that when you look at brokenness, that leads to separation and unforgiveness. What happens to the victims? The victims, very often, they will self-blame themselves. They will blame themselves. And we've seen a lot of times where people have been hurt. And then when you ask them and they will clearly say, no, if I had not done this, I would not have been hurt. If I had not worn a short skirt and walked on the street, the guy would not have sexually molested me. Right? And that's not right. And a lot of times the victims are in denial. They do not want to accept the fact that they have been hurt. That's the problem. And they have resentment. They want to resent. They want to attack. And there's anger, there's revenge, and there's retribution as well. Right? That's what the victims always think about. And then when you look at the perpetrator, many times perpetrators would be justifying, and they justify their actions. They would say, you know what, if that woman or that girl had not won a short skirt, if that woman had not come into my house, if that woman had not, you know, justification, then I would not have done A, B, C, D, and E. Why? So the perpetrators all the time would be justifying whatever actions they have been taking. And also the blame game. Some will blame drugs, some will blame alcohol, some will blame friends, some will blame the environment. I mean, things are happening here with us in the country. And the guys will say, I mean, the legacy of apartheid. Instead of us taking responsibility for the actions, we always look for excuses all the time, right? So there is a video that I want us to play a little bit, if we can just listen to it. Did my video go?
Yeah, it's gone.
Let's go back again. I think, all right. Go back again. I think it was my mouse that I moved it now.
Oh, okay.
Even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness.
And so you can see, you can, as you listen to that video, that song, you can see that there are some words that come through there, like it's hard to give. It's something that is very hard to give. Forgiveness, it's not an easy thing to do. But another thing is that it sets you, the prisoner, free, right? Whoever, if you forgive other people, you are set free. And it's talking about doing the impossible, love the unlovable. What? Doing the impossible, because it's not very possible to forgive. It is very much not natural. So when we look at the next slide, is that in terms of forgiveness, you need to evaluate all relationships. So it's key that you need to look at people, need to reflect on the relationships with God, for instance, right? Those who hurt you and those you have hurt. So it's important to look around and evaluate and check of the relationships that I have had in the past and that are still having. Who are those that I've had and who are those that are hurting me? That's very important. All forgiveness to those who have hurt you. It is important and it is a choice to do. You need to offer forgiveness to those who have hurt you, but and also to make amends to those make amends for harm you have done to others, except when you do so would harm them and other people as well. So it's a choice that one needs to make. And then we look at the power of forgiveness here. And there's a scripture that we share, Jeremiah 6, 14. The Message translation says, my people are broken, they are shattered, and they put on band-aids saying, it's not so bad, you'll be just fine. But things are not just fine. And there we're saying you cannot continue to deny the pain, right? It is a reality. You can change your reactions to it and through faith. But what happens when you cover up a dirty wound? It becomes septic, right? You cannot cover up a dirty wound. It becomes septic and it hurts even more, right? And then we say you can put a band-aid on your pain and believe it will go away. You need to open it up. You just need to clean it out in order to get healing, because you can't cover it up forever. And I believe open wounds heal faster. So it is very key to open up to people when you are hurt, and to go to the perpetrators, to the people that have hurt you, and share with them how much they have hurt you. Now, the power of forgiveness, when you look at what the power of forgiveness will do, is that one of the roots of compulsive behavior is buried pain. And forgiveness breaks that cycle. So we have buried pain that we are keeping inside. And you know what? What I've said earlier on is that hurt people would always hurt other people. Why? And then I've said here that forgiveness will break the cycle. It allows relationships to heal and possibly to start over again. Possibly, it might not always happen, but there's a chance that that might happen. And then also I've said here that forgiveness equals emotional healing, which is key. Forgiveness equals emotional healing. Right? And when you look at what forgiveness is, and here I'll share with you what forgiveness is not. What? Forgiveness is not avoiding justice. Right? So it is not avoiding or escaping justice. And in the justice system that we have in the country, we have what we call the retributive justice system. And the justice system that we have in retributive justice is that is the justice system that makes you to pay. It's for punishment. You need to pay for the wrongs that you have done. And what happens with the justice system is that it leaves out the victim. What? In our court system currently right now, when somebody has stabbed or murdered or assaulted someone else, the only time the victim gets involved is when they go and open a case and give a statement. But when you go to court, the state takes over. So it becomes Joseph versus the state in that case. And what happens is that we close the door for the victims. And victims always want to know. There's somebody talking.
Gents, please, can we mute? Please, can we mute, guys? Thank you. Thank you, leadership.
So with the justice that we have is that the victims always will want to know, why me? What happened? They've got questions and they're seeking for truthful questions. And the reason why there's a lot of unforgiveness that's happening is because people are not opening up. People are not asking questions. And people are not getting the questions that the answers to the questions that they have been asking. Right. So we have restorative justice as well. And restorative justice, the one that we present, is the one that introduces and gives power to the victim as well. In this an example case, in this point is Janus Waluz. I mean, Janus Waluz killed Chris Hani long time ago, 1992, and is sitting in prison. I think that guy is due for parole according to the law of the country, but he's not been given parole because Dimpo Hani says, no, I'm not forgiving this guy because he has not spoken the truth. He has not come up with the truth. Why, who, what happened? All those questions are still lacking. That's the reason why he's still sitting in there. So victims want to get their answers and truthful answers. In that way, they themselves are able now to consider forgiveness. Secondly, forgiveness is not, secondly, victim is not, forgiveness is not letting the guilt off the hook. What? It is moving the guilt from the hook of or from my hook or your hook to God's hook. So you don't let them go free. What? That's not the case. And then the third point is that forgiveness here is not blameless. What? It does not excuse the unjust behavior and does not make people blameless. They still must take responsibility for their actions. They still must take responsibility for what they have done. And it is very key. So they cannot now come and blame other things. And it does not wipe away the consequences. They still must account for what they have done. And it is not based on, and it is not fair, basically. Because when you look at what Jesus went through, he went through to the cross. And was it fair for him to go to the cross for our forgiveness? It is really not fair. So forgiveness is really not fair here. And then also, forgiveness is not denying what the other people has done, right? It's not denying the emotions and the hurt and the anger that we are going through, the people that have been hurt, right? It is working through the emotions. It is feeling the hurt and also releasing it. It's not about being weak. When you forgive, doesn't mean that you are weak, not at all. In fact, you become powerful because it gives you the power. You can do whatever you want. That's what forgiveness does. So forgiveness does not make you weak per se. And then the other point that we have, sorry, my slide is too small. My thing is failing me. Right. So forgiveness gives you time to heal. It will give you time to heal. Yeah. So it's not waiting for time to heal here, all the wounds. And we are saying some people just do not allow healing to take place. So it's not all. So you need time to heal, basically, when you have been hurt. And we say here, it is not natural. It's never natural. But you need God's supernatural power, empowerment to be able to forgive. Because on your own, you do not have the power to forgive. And forgiveness is not conditional. You cannot put conditions to forgiveness. For instance, people would say, but they have not opened up to me, so therefore I will not forgive, or they have not taken responsibility for their actions, and therefore I would not forgive. It's not conditional. You forgive because God wants you to forgive. And then also we're saying it's not the feeling, right? You don't feel forgiving. You have to feel. It's not a feeling. It is an act of your will. So it is a choice that you make when you forgive. And then last point that I want to share is that forgiveness is not forgetting. Does not mean forgetting at all. Right? Because your brain does not and is not made to forget anything. You need to remember before you forgive. So your brain is not made to forget anything. You will always remember. And a lot of people will say, right, I will forgive, but I will not forget, which is true. But you cannot forgive and forget. Now, let's look at what forgiveness is all about. And it is a commandment from God. The commandment from God, when you look at Matthew 6, in the Lord's Prayer, we are saying, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. So forgive us, Lord, our wrongs as we forgive those who have wronged us. So it's there. It's a command. And secondly, it's releasing resentment. So you forgo of resentment. You do not want to punish the other person that has wronged you. And you're releasing your resentment towards the offender. You release the right to hear, I'm sorry. You're releasing all that right. You're not waiting for them to say, we are sorry. And you release the right to be bitter as well. And you release that right to get even with them. So in forgiveness, you cannot go on and want to harm the person whom you have released or given forgiveness to. And the third point is that it is letting go, right? It is letting go of the offense. Remember we said it is not forgetting, but you let go of the offense, release the right to dwell on the offense, release the right to hold on to the offense. And typical example here is when God was speaking in Isaiah 43, verse 25, 26, and he speaks about all the good things that we have not done to him. Right? And then he speaks about all the bad things. He says, your sin is wearing me. So he gets tired about our sins. So there's an impact that sin or wrong that is done to us happens. But he says, but I am the one who blots out your transgressions. And even says, for my own sake, and your sins I'll remember no more. Right? And the key word there is for my own sake. Right? So it is not the person, and you are not doing a favor to the person who has hurt you, but you are doing yourself a favor. So letting go of the offense is you releasing the right to dwell on the offense, and also release the right to hold on to the offense, and you are able to move on. And then also you're releasing the right to bring up the offense, and also releasing the right to take revenge. So whenever wrong has been done to you and you forgive him, when the person comes back again and they do the same thing to you, you cannot remind them of the wrong that they had done previously that you had forgiven them. In that case, it means then, therefore, you have not forgiven at all. Why? So in releasing the right to take the revenge is that you are giving it to God to take care of it. Because God in Romans 12, verse 19 says, do not take revenge, because he says, wrath belongs to me. What? God is the one who avenges for our case. So you are releasing the revenge. You don't want to go back to want to revenge and hurt the people that have hurt you. What? And then the next slide is that what forgiveness does is that it sets you free. And the illustration here is that keeping something against someone is a problem. Unforgiveness binds your spirit to that person. What? And forgiveness sets you free. Remember what happens when you are not forgiving somebody is that you have to forever watch them. You have to forever think about them. And they have forgotten, probably. They are having fun. They're moving on with their life. And you are sitting here with a pity party. Yes, you have been hurt, but it's up to you to be released, to be set free, right? So you are not able to progress in life because, for instance, as an illustration, is that when somebody has hurt you and you want revenge, you want to make sure that they don't progress in life. Whenever there's a business opportunity that they have gotten, and what happens is that you wish they could fail. So all the time, whatever you are doing, you're watching them. You wish things could go wrong in their lives. So forgiveness does not do anything to the person who has wronged you, but it's got a lot to do with you who has been wronged, and it sets you free. So the next slide is that when we look at forgiveness, we need to reflect. And it's a reflection. And also what I'm trying to say is that, you know, forgiveness reflects part of the character of God. It's a reflection of God's character, right? Because what it happens is that it extends mercy to the people that have wronged you, right? And then it gives a gift of grace, like we have received grace all the time. And then it sets an offender free without them having come and accepted the wrong over to you. But it just happens. You have to go through that whole process. Now, when you look at forgiveness and reconciliation, because there's another point that we need to look at, is that forgiveness is never and never will be equals to reconciliation. They are never the same. It is not possible for reconciliation to happen without forgiveness. But it is possible for reconciliation to happen with forgiveness. Reconciliation might not happen depending on the individuals, but most of the time is that amends are made depending on the individuals involved. But forgiveness involves one person. It is one person who let go of the right to an offense. Whereas reconciliation involves two people or more, involves the whole community. And reconciliation cannot happen, it's not one-sided. The offender cannot come in and say, I wanna reconcile with you without them having confessed all the wrong and taken responsibility for the wrong that they have done and have shown and apologized to you and have shown remorse. And then forgiveness happens, then reconciliation can happen. So forgiveness is not the same as reconciliation. And forgiveness is, however, the first step towards reconciliation. So if you forgive, you have started a process going towards reconciliation. And forgiveness focuses on the offense and requires no relationship at all. So we are saying when you forgive, you are foregoing and you are releasing yourself from the offense. And it has got nothing to do with somebody that has hurt you. It only needs one person and can only be a one-way action. To forgive, you don't need reconciliation. That's period. You do not need reconciliation. But reconciliation is focused on a relationship between two people. It needs at least two or more people. And it's a give and take, two-way action. So both parties have got to lose something. The perpetrator has got to lose the right to justification for the actions that they have done. Whereas the victim has got to lose the right to resentment, to revenging them. So for reconciliation, as we said, you need forgiveness. You cannot have reconciliation without forgiveness. Tough. It can't happen. Why? So when we look at forgiveness and reconciliation also, some of the questions will be, after forgiveness, must we be reconciled? And I'm sure some of the questions you guys are writing down the questions there. After forgiveness, must we be reconciled? The first answer is yes. You must be reconciled. And we take this from 2 Corinthians 5:18 to 19, the Message translation. It says, all this comes from God who settled the relationship between us and him, and then called us to settle our relationship with each other. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. God has given us the task of telling everyone what he is doing. In fact, another translation says, God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. So when you are a child of God, you've got a ministry of reconciliation. God says you need to forgive. And then also you've got a ministry of reconciliation. I mean, we look at an illustration where in Matthew 5, Jesus says when he's teaching, he says, if you come to the altar and you want to offer your sacrifice, and there you remember that your brother has got something against you. Remember, it is you who is wrong. You don't have anything against your brother, but you are on the wrong. And maybe probably your brother has tried to correct you. But then Jesus says, there and there, you must leave your gift at the door. Go back, be reconciled to your brother, and then you can come back and offer. So you can see that God does not need anything from us up until when we have been reconciled. And we need to take responsibility for our actions. And another answer is no. You must not be reconciled. Why? 1 Corinthians 15:33, NIV version says, do not be misled because bad company corrupts good character.
Yes.
So you can see the same author, Apostle Paul, writes to us here, and he says, you've got a ministry of reconciliation. Right? And you look at it, he says, you need to be reconciled. After forgiveness, you need to be reconciled. But then also, in 1 Corinthians 15, he turns around and he says, no, but depending on the circumstance and the situation, but bad company corrupts good character. Sometimes there is a need not to forgive, to be reconciled, right? So here are the questions, and I've said before that you can never give something that you do not have. If I meet you on the road, and I ask you to give me your Maserati, the car, most expensive car, and you don't have it, you can't give it to me. But if you have 10 Maseratis and you are loaded, and I ask you for the car, you can give it to me. If I ask you for money and you do not have money, you can't give it to me. So same as forgiveness. If you have not been forgiven, if you have not received forgiveness that comes from above, it becomes very difficult for you to forgive. So have you accepted God's forgiveness? That's the question. Because Apostle Peter asked the question, how many times must we forgive a day? And he gave an answer. He said, you know, seven times. And the Lord says 70 times seven. How much more? 70 times seven. Can you count per day? Right. So have you accepted his forgiveness? Right. Remember, if God wasn't willing to forgive sin, heaven will be empty. So God is willing to forgive us. So have you accepted his forgiveness? The second question is, have you forgiven others? Which is key. And this type of forgiveness is a process. You need to be willing. But to be truly free, you must let go of the pain of the past. You know, the harm and the abuse caused by others. Let go. You need to let go. Why? Have you forgiven others? And the third one is, have you forgiven God? Because a lot of questions will say, but how do you forgive God? You receive forgiveness from him. Now, how do you forgive God? And as children of God, many times we've had situations where things have happened and we've questioned and we said, where is God in this? Why is God allowing this to happen to me? Why? So it is time for one to forgive God as well. And the last one is, have you forgiven yourself? Because what happens is that as a human being, as you are living and walking, you have this guy called self. And this guy called self is like a shadow that goes everywhere with you. This guy self is the one that you need to control. And this guy self is the one who leads you astray. So have you forgiven yourself? Because without any of these 4 points, it's gonna be difficult, my friends, to forgive. How do you forgive? Step two to forgiveness. You need to talk to someone you trust and open up about how hurt, sad, and angry you may feel. You need to open up to someone. And many times we are in denial, upset as victims. We are in denial. We cover up with the bandages that, you know, the wound will be okay, whereas it is not okay. When you have been hurt, you need to open up to somebody. Let your emotions out and do not apologize for your emotions. Let those emotions out. The third point is that don't withdraw or isolate yourself. And this is exactly what many people do. Stay connected and feel the pain, even though it hurts. You need to fall in love with what has happened so that you take introspection. You need to open up, right? And then also, you need to get somebody to listen to you. And when you have somebody listening to you, the pain is more bearable. The pain would always be there. It's not gonna go away. It will always be there. But your step to forgiveness is you need to open up to somebody you trust. And it's not just anybody, right? The worst thing that you would want to happen to you is that to tell somebody how much you've been hurt. And then you hear about your story, your hurt from somewhere else. That is bad. That is even more hurtful as well. But you need to make sure that you pray to God to send you somebody that is trustworthy, that you can share with that. But I always say that you need to open up to somebody who can pray with you. And if somebody cannot pray with you, never go and open up things to that person. That's clear. All right. So How do you forgive others? Because it's important. Once you have received the forgiveness from God, once you have received the forgiveness for yourself, how then do you forgive others? And there's a step process that happens, right? In prayer and meditation, you need to pray, right? Again, you cannot heal a hurt you do not acknowledge. You need to acknowledge the fact that you have been hurt, right? If you don't do that, it becomes buried pain. And buried pain eats you up from inside and causing all sorts of trouble in your life, like bitterness, also like depression, illness, like anger, resentment, all sorts of things happen. So you need to acknowledge the fact that you have been hurt. The second point is that you must have a journal. As you are praying, ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you one at a time the people that have hurt and disappointed you in meditation. Whilst you are doing that, you start to write down the names and offenses that are causing you to hold on to unforgiveness. You need to write them down. And normally what we do with lots of people is we jot everything down, and then we take all the papers and we go and we bend them and we pray over them and we bend them. So it is important that you always generalize everything, jot everything down, right? Admit hurt and harm. Face the hurts, resentments and wrongs others have caused you or that you have caused others, because it's not a one-way street. Basically, we do the same thing to us. So don't minimize the offense. Don't say it's nothing. It's something small. It is not. Every hurt is important. Don't excuse the offender's behavior. But do not cover up for them. A lot of times the victims will say, you know, if I had not gone out at night, I would not have been robbed. You have the right to go anywhere you want in the country. And the offenders do not have the right to rob you. So as a victim, you cannot excuse the offender's behavior at all. Don't assume that quick forgiveness is full forgiveness. Be aware that you might not think you have a right to feel hurt or wronged, but that you still do feel that that way in your subconscious mind. In your subconscious mind, you still feel that way, especially towards God as well, right? And then the next point that I looked at is you need to feel the emotions. Feel the emotions that are attached to that offense. Feeling the pain must happen before healing can take place. Do not deny the pain. Get rid of the false guilt, right? Like, I should not be feeling this way, as an example. No, you have to show the feelings, right? You need to feel the emotions. And then the last point that we're looking at is you look at your contribution as well, right? Acknowledge your responsibility and contribution to the problem. Focus on your contribution to the problem and deal with the emotions surrounding that. Don't make excuses or attempts to justify your actions as well. Take responsibility also. And then from there, you can forgive. If you follow that step, it becomes quite easier for you to forgive, right? How do you forgive yourself as well? The same process. Something must happen. You must confess your shortcomings. Confess everything that you have done. Confess your sins. Confess your resentments. Right? James 5:16 says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. So it is important to confess, because when you confess, you come clean, or you own up, you agree with God, you obey God's direction and command. So by agreeing with God, God is able to help you move away from the hurt that you are facing. The second point is that you need to face the facts. And many times we don't want to acknowledge that we we have been wronged, right? Face the facts in the light of truth, right? And we're saying for you to recover, honesty is required, right? You need to be very honest. And John 8:12 says, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Right. The next point is you need to ease the pain. Pain is inevitable, but misery is optional. Can I repeat it again? Pain is inevitable. When you are hurt, pain is, you cannot run away from pain. But to be misery, it's a choice. It's optional. And we find that this in Psalm 32:35, right? We are as only as sick as our secrets. When we share our deepest secrets, we begin to divide the pain and shame, right? So it says that there was a time when I wouldn't admit what a sinner I was. This is David here. Yeah. But my dishonesty made me miserable and filled my days with frustration. My strength evaporated like water on a sunny day until I finally admitted all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide them. I said to myself, I will confess them to the Lord. And you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. The next point is stop the blame. And the truth is, we cannot find peace and serenity if we continue to blame ourselves or others. Our secrets have isolated us from each other long enough. But so we cannot continue to blame. And the last point here is, there's no more guilt once you start accepting God's forgiveness. And God says there in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful enough to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we need to receive forgiveness from God. And as a result of that, then we don't have any blame. And you know, there are physical effects of unforgiveness. When we are sitting without forgiveness, there's a lot that happens inside of you. For instance, if we look at that, when we don't forgive and experience symptoms, we then experience symptoms of sadness, depression, or anxiety, the serotonin levels in our brain are lower than they should be, which can also lead to other issues such as obsessive thinking. So as soon as our serotonin levels are lower, we go through depression, so it becomes a vicious cycle. So forgiveness has got a challenge on its own, and you cannot afford to go through unforgiveness. And I've got a video next that I want to share that speaks to the physical effects of unforgiveness. And I'm about to wrap up now. So if you can just watch the video quickly, if it's true, it will come.
No, toxic is when we invest through body functions in electrical, chemical feedback loop. So if you don't think correctly, the way that the nerves of the countries, and I just so clearly explained.
The volume seems low, Malida.
Is the volume too low?
But if it's toxic,
too low, yeah.
Forms on and it becomes a negative. Like a briar. And it takes up space and it occupies space and it grows through the brain, and things like anger and hate and bitterness and rejection and those things, that memory looks different to a good, happy, positive memory in your brain. And when you have those toxic memories actually physically growing, because it's a physical thing that actually happens in your brain, it actually physically grows, it upsets the whole electrical chemical feedback loop in the brain. And then that causes your whole body to, that thought is translated by the middle part of your brain into a physical reaction in your body. So toxic thinking in your brain will actually become a physical reaction in your body. So the way in which you think will affect your intellect, your emotions, and your physical health. And if you know, we can understand that that is a reality, we can also change it, because the scientific research shows us that you can grow your brain at will. So if you've grown a toxic thought, you can actually fix that up. which is amazing. Because if you think that, you know, if you have an abuse or a rejection or a bitterness or any kind of that becomes a thought that's in your head, because your brain, everything begins and ends in the brain. So if you've got this toxic thought, this toxic emotion in your brain, this actual memory that looks a bit like a tree and it's got all these thorns on, you can actually deal with that. God gives you his incredible, incredible ability. Within 4 days, you can start changing the way in which your brain functions. So through correct thinking,
you can take that negative, almost like an abscess, and you can eliminate it and get, say, like an even more healthy blood flow.
Absolutely.
In which you can actually go from no fruitfulness, like the Bible talks about a root of bitterness.
Yes, yes.
Would that bitterness like be a deposit?
It'll be a deposit with thorns on it. Actually, literally grows.
Can you actually see that?
You can actually see that. I've actually got a picture over here. If you have a look at this picture over here, what we have over here is an image of the inside of the brain. And over there is a very, it's a minute portion of the brain that's been magnified, and it looks like a whole lot of spaghetti and meatballs. But that over there is a very strong memory with lots of branches. Now, the more you think, the more branches you grow, because that's where the branches actually hold the information that's coming in. Now, if it's a good memory, that's a good memory. That's a healthy memory. But when it becomes negative, it actually creates that kind of effect, like a black hole. Because when you learn,
it's like an abscess.
It's like an abscess. Mm-hmm. Literally becomes like an abscess. As you are thinking, it's learning is an electrical chemical process. So in order to grow those branches, you need electrical activity and you need chemicals. Now, if it's a positive, if it's a what I call a faith-based emotion or a faith-based memory, you're going to pick up the right kind of chemicals and you'll build a good, healthy memory. You'll build one of these kind of memories, a healthy memory. But if it is a negative one, if it's a fear-based emotion, it's only fear or faith-based emotions. So all the negative emotions come out of fear. And if it's one of those, you'll actually pick up the wrong amount of chemicals and the wrong type of chemicals. And then you'll all the excess chemicals literally grow little thorns on the trees and change the whole electrical chemical status around the memory. And it becomes this black hovering negative cloud. And that then stimulates a whole release of chemicals through your brain, puts your body into the stress reaction and makes us mentally into stress.
Depression would be...
Well, depression is a side effect of stress. Now, what happens is that the result of toxic thinking is a physical reaction in your body called stress. So stress has got three stages, and stress is really the reaction of a toxic thought. The first stage of stress is good because that's what we use to actually build memories. It alerts us and prepares us for the memory building process. But your body's only supposed to be in that state for a very short time. What happens, however, is that...
Is that like an adrenaline rush?
Like it is. And it's
similar?
That's right. It gets the blood flowing and it gets your brain prepared to build memories. But it's only a short period of time. Then what happens is if your body stays in that stress reaction, those chemicals are not supposed to flow for too long. If your thinking is toxic, if you started building one of these memories, your body will shift over into the stage of two of stress, and your body will start releasing chemicals throughout the body that affect the way in which you function. It affects your intellect, it affects your emotions, it affects your physical body, and there's a very specific route that it travels through your body. So literally, you've got an area of your brain called the deep limbic system, and that's the internal part of your brain, and that deals with all our emotions. It's what I call the chemical factory. It's a part of your brain that secretes the chemicals that we need to build memory. Now, if that part of your brain is secreting the wrong kind of memory, it responds to your thought life. It responds to the memories that you've built. So if you are activating negative memories, this chemical factory will secrete negative chemicals and will build these toxic thoughts, and you'll get a physical reaction in your body.
Well, can this be reversed?
That it can be, and that's the good thing. So you can, let's say that that's a negative memory and it's an abuse or a rejection or a bitterness. Actually, you can't build another memory over that memory until you've dealt with that memory. You know, it's the principle of like unto like. So what one has to do is deal with that memory first, that toxic emotion first. So you have to consciously bring all thoughts into captivity to Christ Jesus. You've got to actually examine that.
Now, you've got a PhD. You studied the brain. Look at this thing scientifically. You just threw a scripture out, like take thoughts captive. Like you believe that when the Bible talks about strongholds, it would be like a grip, almost like a mental fortress.
That's a stronghold. You believe
that is more than just a, let's say, a spiritual reference or truth or statement or what somebody might believe is true. You believe it is provable that if you've got hurt, or you've got bitterness, or let's say you have lustful thinking, you've programmed, addicted. Thoughts, these bad anger, all these things, you're saying it becomes like a stronghold that you could actually identify in the brain, and that the opposite of that, you can actually identify in the brain where someone has developed not only their memory bank, but the positive input and impressions, and it looks more like something that's fruitful and productive.
Absolutely. It's a physical change that actually occurs, because that will secrete, that will cause a secretion of chemicals and electrical activity and magnetic activity in the brain that is different to a healthy memory. And you can actually change those. It's a physical thing in the brain. It looks different. And in this medical research and the scientific research, they have shown that in order to overcome that, you have to go through a process of forgiveness and repentance. And these are, this is coming out of the medical laboratories where they're not even talking about.
The medical community would talk about this. You can't hold resentment without doing damage.
Without doing damage. It actually causes damage in the brain. And they're actually advocating that you go through a process of releasing and forgiving and bringing those, you know, controlling your thought life. And as you control your thought life, as you forgive and you release, those thorns start falling off. As you forgive someone, those thorns literally, their chemical structure changes, and those thorns literally fall off, and that memory changes. Now, it doesn't go away. Like, you'll remember the things that you went through in your past.
Right. It doesn't have a hold on you.
No, it doesn't have a hold, because you literally then can grow the new memory over the old memory. So you can remember the old, but the new one now is the healed memory that you can actually deal with the past.
Amazing. Amazing stuff. That, you know, that the physical leaching of unforgiveness that it has on our bodies is immeasurable. So you need to change, like what the Bible says, as a man thinks, so he is. So we need to change our thought process. But when we look at Romans 12, Romans 12 says, where Paul is talking to the Romans, he says in verse number 2, do not conform to the standard of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of the mind. So you are able to renew your mind. You are able to speak different things to your mind, for your mind to change, so that there's a benefit to it, right? It says so that you are able to see and test the perfect will of God for you. So it is very key what we think. So you need to start living the promises of recovery. Acknowledge your emotions about the harm done to you and how they affect your behavior, and work to release them. And it's very key. Acknowledgement is very key. Choose to forgive the person who's offended to you. Remember, forgiveness is a choice. You choose to forgive. It does not just happen. And you move away from your role as a victim, because sometimes we have this victim mentality, and that holds us up a lot. So you need to move away from your role as a victim and release the control and power the offending person and situation have had in your life, because you are empowering them. When you become a victim, you are empowering the offender. So you need to take charge. You need to take over your life by moving away from being a victim. Move away from victim mentality. Right. I don't know if there are any other questions. This was my last slide.
Yeah, thank you, leadership. Thank you very much for a great presentation. I have certainly taken a lot from what you have presented, and I would like to believe that our viewers here and our attendees here have taken a lot as well. While they're preparing their questions, I have one question already from my side that I want to ask. And it is out of the passion of this club that I have this question. And I have mentioned earlier that the book of Matthew 16, verse 19 to 20, talks about, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was Christ. So forgiveness has consumed and eaten us to a point where reconciliation is a foreign concept at all, that we don't even think of reconciling. Yeah. So in the context of this club, we have lots of men here. And in some of the programs, when we talk, we're saying to men, look, you have to go back and reconcile, whether it's your fault or it's not your fault. And a typical example here would be a man who's got a children with another woman they're not married to, and or a man who's got a child, and for many years he has denied his fatherhood of those children. At some point, he needs, as a man, to go back. It's very important. So how do you, this will be my question, to give these men, or to give us as men and women who are here, the tools to initiate a process of forgiveness and maybe ultimately reconciliation, in the context of which I have explained that here you are, you are a father, you have clearly are at guilt. Someone else, a stepfather or a mother, you cannot pass this world while you still have that hanging in your back. So in the context of that here, how do you give us tools to, for a man who has denied his responsibility, or a man who has offended and he's got this ego that I cannot initiate forgiveness? How do you have tools that you can give them on how to initiate this without thinking of themselves as lower, but thinking of them, the goal that they want to achieve, that I want to reconcile and be with my family? And I'm asking this in this context because we often see Kumbule Kaya, people going back. We often see Abu Tatago, people trying to reconcile a lot of these programs happening. But we want to extend it to every man to have strength and wisdom to do these things. I don't know if my question is clear enough. I know I've spoken for a while.
Well, yes, I've captured it. Am I clear? Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
All right. Okay. I've listened to your question, and let me try and rephrase it. What you've asked, you are saying, here is a man who has not taken responsibility for his family. He's got a child out of wedlock, and he's gone away for a long time, and he wants to make things happen. He wants reconciliation to take place. Right. Remember what we had said. What we had said, that reconciliation is a two-way thing. It cannot be offered and initiated by one person. Right. So the offending person needs to acknowledge first that they have wronged, they have offended, they need to realize the wrongs that they have done, humble themselves, right? They need to approach the family. If there is a child from outside, and what we are saying, we are not saying bring the child, probably you are now married to someone else and there is a child out of wedlock. We are not saying bring the child into the family, but you need, as a man, take responsibility towards the upbringing of your child. So do the right thing. When I go inside prison and I do the programs, I think more than 80% of men who are incarcerated come from absent father homes or fatherless homes, right? Absent fathers, fathers who are there but not there, right? Fathers who have given birth and walked away, and their single mothers have raised this child, and this child, anger grows up, and they've got questions, and they want answers, and there are no answers, and eventually they end up with the wrong group and they end up in prison. And these are the guys that we meet. So it is important for men to take responsibility for their offspring. So the first thing that needs to happen is you need to initiate, as Black people, African people, what we do is, I'm sure when you have done wrong in another home, you tend to send people to that home. So we send the elders to that home so that they can go and acknowledge the wrong that you have done. Even it goes as far as Ukbatala, Intaulo, whatever other things. But That is the first thing. So once that you take that step, it shows that you really want to make things happen. So you give them the opportunity, explain to them. Many times people are saying, can I ask for forgiveness? As an offender, you have no right to ask for forgiveness. The reason here being, when you ask for something, you expect to receive, right? And when that which you have asked is not given to you, is denied, you walk away disappointed. In fact, you've got a load on your shoulders that you have taken to that other person, you ask for forgiveness, and they reject you, you walk away with your load, right? Our responsibility is to repent. If you've done wrong, you repent. Promise, acknowledge the wrong, acknowledge the harm that has been caused, promise to make amends, and then let the other family or the other people come up with a decision to forgive once they have healed. They forgive, then reconciliation can take place.
Okay.
But the first step is repentance. When you look at Luke 17, verse 3 and 4, Jesus says, if your brother sins against you, says rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times he repents, forgive him. So the offender's responsibility is to repent.
I think what you said links directly with the question of Reverend Francis Molloy here. And I think I would like you to talk to it. He says a lot of questions that are being asked outside there. Can you forgive someone who doesn't show any remorse? And this is the part two of this question says, part one is, can you forgive someone who doesn't show remorse? This person doesn't even say, please forgive me, or I'm sorry about what I've done, or whatever. The part two of his question goes and says, can you trust that offender is really not going to repeat the same again? If number one, the person doesn't show remorse and you forgive them. Number two, can you trust that I'm still with the right person here? Because this person has never showed anything that indicates that he's remorseful of what he has done.
Remember what we had said before. We have said forgiveness has got nothing to do with the other person. It's got a lot to do with you who has been hurt, right? So I think I've got a question that I had put on here that says, should you forgive someone who keeps hurting you? Can you see this question? Right.
Yes.
Both with the same one, the guy who does not repent. Right. So it says moving away from that someone who repeatedly hurts you makes for a safer space in your life. You still have to forgive, but then you move away from that person. Right. And forgiving them makes for a stress-free space in your mind. Remember, setting boundaries, that is marking what behaviors of others you will allow towards yourself, does not mean remaining vindictive to the offender. So you discuss with them. Remember, forgiveness releases you from the prison. That's got nothing to do with the offender. So you go and you tell them and you show them how hurtful they have been to you. And if they don't want to take responsibility, you've said what you have said and you move along.
Great. Thank you. I see Israel's hand is up. Mutapil, the platform is yours.
Thank you very much. And my chairperson, and thanks to our presenter, Mr. Chris. So I just wanted to, I'm thinking on behalf of just a layman, who's not strongly vested in the Bible, So I wanted to check if we can just emphasize the how effective or the relationship between closure and forgiveness, if I can ask. Maybe if you can please dwell on that also and clarify that the relationship between closure and forgiveness, how well do they relate? Or if I can ask, I'm not sure if my question is very clear.
So your question is the relationship between between forgiveness and closure.
Yes, and closure.
Right. This is what happens in life, basically. I think they're interrelated. The two are interrelated, right? Victims always are asking for truthful answers. They are asking questions and they want answers. And why do they want answers? Because they want to get to closure. They want to settle the matter, right? So if a child has not had a father in a long time and the father has gone away, gone with the world, right? And he keeps on asking, he wants to know why. And eventually when he gets to meet the father and he asks the questions, he wants to be given truthful answers, not jiga-jiga, not blaming other things, right? So the father needs to come out truthfully and tell them the real reasons why his actions were that way, that it has hurt the child. And that way, closure is, you know, you get to find closure. Typical example, let's look at Chris Hani's case, for instance, that I've brought it in, right? There's still questions. Poor Hani is still asking questions. There are no answers. Waluz Jaluz and all the other people have not given her the answer. So she will not forgive that person. And therefore there is no closure because you really do not know exactly what happened. Post-apartheid, we had what we call truth and reconciliation process, the TRC, right? That commission that happened. A lot of people were killed and the families wanted to know where they were buried, who killed them, why they were killed. And there has not been any closure for a whole lot of families. Some have gone in and gotten their bones, their skeletons, to come and rebury them. And those families have gotten to closure and probably maybe they have even forgiven. But forgiveness is about you releasing yourself from the offense. And thereafter, once you have gone and met with the perpetrator and they have revealed, given you all the questions that you've asked, you are therefore then able to reach closure.
Beautiful. I got that. I hope Leadership Sekgale, did you get your response?
I did so very much. Thank you very much.
Okay. Great stuff. My question that I was going to ask has nicely been answered on your slide that you have put up here. Moving away from someone who repeatedly hurts you makes a safer space. You become sane. And forgiving them makes a less stress-free space in your mind. Remember, setting boundaries, that is making what behaviors of others will or will not allow towards yourself, does not mean remaining vindictive to the other person. That slide answers me very, very beautifully. And I hope it answers a whole lot of people as well here. Leaders, can I see a raise of hand? Can you check on Facebook if there's questions or any other question? Anybody?
My leadership, I think there's a question in the chat box by leader Luhlanga. I don't know if you can be able to see that side.
I can't, leader. Can you please read it for us?
All right, thank you very much. It's saying, I understand the Bible about forgiving him or her 7 by 70, but what if that person is doing the same thing? That's the question, how it's structured.
Yeah. I think already this light that is sitting in our face is responding to that question. But let me allow Chris to take over.
I think forgiveness is not natural. I've said it before, right? There comes a time when you need empowerment from God to forgive. Right. We are repeatedly going to be hurt. and all the same hurts are going to come towards us. Remember, you are not in control of the other person's behavior, but your control is how you can respond to what they are doing to you. You are responsible for that. So Jesus says 70 times 7 in a day. It's a lot. Can you really sit down and count? It is tiring. It's unbearable. You cannot do it. Luke 17 says, if he comes to you and he sins against you seven times, and seven times he repents, it means he's come with the same challenge. He stepped on your toes seven times. He has not done anything different. He's done the same thing seven times, and he repents seven times. Jesus says, forgive him, because your responsibility is forgiveness, because it releases you. For your own sake, I've said Isaiah 43, 24, 25, God speaks about all the bad things the Israelites have done to him. And those things have burdened him, have worried him. Can you imagine Mudimu Akhatala? And we are saying he's almighty, but Wakhatala. So it's just an illustration for us. It says, for my own sake, I will blot out your transgressions and your sins I will never remember. Does God forget? No. That's not the real meaning. The true meaning of your sins I will not remember is that he will not bring up your sins. When there is another sin that you commit, he does not go and fish it out and bring and say, but yesterday you did the same thing. So you are giving grace, and grace is unmerited favor. You're extending grace.
Yeah, beautiful. Nicely answered. I hope the leader down there has gotten the response. And I see your hand is up, my leader. Do you want to see something?
Yes, it's yet another question, unless there are other leaders whom they might be willing to ask some questions. I just wanted to check the effectiveness of forgiving in silence. I mean,
they'll raise them.
Thank you. I saw the steps of forgiveness mostly is engaging with others and all that. So I wanted to just check how effective it is to forgive in silence when you don't have to even let the person that you are forgiving know. So I just wanted to check that. How effective it is to forgive in silence without having to reach out to the other person. That's my question, my leader.
Thank you, leader. Thank you very much. Let's let Brother Chris to jump into it.
All right, silent forgiveness. Let me throw it back. Let me throw back the question, right, with another question as an answer. What happens if somebody who has hurt you have gone and they are in the States, or they have died, for instance, and you are sitting with resentment, anger, and everything, and you need to forgive? How do you forgive such a person? Person that has died, how do you forgive? Remember, it's not about the other person who has offended you. Forgiveness releases you. So you do not have to meet with the perpetrator and tell them that you are forgiving them. Yes, the whole process as put down in Matthew 18, it says, if your brother has sinned against you, it says you confront him, you speak to him, right? Between the two of you. If you would not let go and he still wants to continue with the same thing, so he says you call two or three other witnesses so that your thing might be tested by witnesses. So if still he doesn't want to listen, he says you take him to the church board. If within the church he still doesn't want to listen, so he says you treat him like a heathen and a tax collector. Well, that's the process. You need to confront. But what happens when you cannot confront? What happens? And it's wearing you. The things that they've done to you are affecting your day-to-day lives, and they are not here. You need to forgive, and it's in silence. They don't have to be there, because forgiveness is a one-way street. Doesn't have to involve the other person. You are freeing yourself. This is what Nelson Mandela says. when he got released. He says, as I walked out of the door towards my freedom, I knew that if I did not leave all the anger, hatred, and bitterness behind, that I would still be in prison. So he's leaving Victor Fester prison. And he says, if I don't release all those things, I would still remain in Victor Fester prison whilst I'm out there. So we have a lot of people that are walking bound, imprisonment, by unforgiveness, by bitterness, by anger, by all sorts of things. Right? Because they don't want to let go. They don't want to release. They are waiting for the person to come and apologize. And if the person doesn't come, they continue living a stressful life. It's a problem. So yes, silent forgiveness, you can do it with the person not knowing you're forgiven, because it's all about you and not the other person.
Yeah, beautiful. Well said. I hope leadership has got that. Brother Chris, we feel at Saljek, and maybe even outside the club, we feel that as men, we have lost lineage. And it happened long before our times. We are battling to recover and find who we are, so that once we know who we are moving forward, we'll be able to implant in our children the right information that they remember life. It's almost like a relay marathon. It's a relay. We're handing over the baton to the small youngs who are coming and taking it moving forward with. So having lost so much lineage, for whatever reason, being it our fault or being anybody's fault, that has happened. And leaders, can we mute, please, gents? So the challenge that we're sitting with is we are trying to normalize, because most people will tell you, hey, it's very difficult to forgive. Yes. Or it's even very difficult to ask for forgiveness. How do you respond to that? People find it difficult to forgive, or mostly they find it difficult to ask for forgiveness. They would rather bring gifts. I know you mentioned something like that. You read in the Bible a scripture that talks to that. They rather bring gifts and give them to you in a hope that you will notice that they're seeking forgiveness. How do we normalize that? Because this is what we're trying to normalize here. Because if we normalize forgiveness within families, within communities, we are starting to build leaders that will take over from us tomorrow when we have parted.
What we need, indeed, it is very, very difficult to forgive. And it is also very difficult to ask for forgiveness, as I have indicated and I've said. As an offender, you never ask for forgiveness. Your role is to take, and we need to teach this to everyone else. Your role is to take full responsibility for the actions and for everything that you've done wrong to the people, to anyone else. So what you do is you go and you confront that person. You share with them the hurt that you have caused. But you promise to make amends. You promise not to repeat it again. And then that's it, and you leave it with them. Then it is up to, the ball is now in their court, to then decide to forgive, because you have shown remorse. You've come, you've said your say, and that's it. You never ask for forgiveness. You go and you apologize. In Zulu, they put it very nicely. They say, we are xolisa, kunalo ukuxolisa, kunalo ucela uxolo. There are two things. So you don't cela uxolo, you go and xolisa. You go and apologize for the wrongs that you have done. That's exactly what we do with the offenders inside. The first thing that we do with our program is that we say, we show them what is sin, what is crime. They speak about crime themselves. What is crime? And then the next point, we talk to them about taking responsibility, to say, you need to take responsibility. How do you take responsibility? It brings us to the third point that says you confess and repent. So you confess. Confession is confessing all the wrongs that you have done. And once you've done confession and repentance, then forgiveness will then come into play. We talk about forgiveness. From forgiveness, we talk about making amends or restitution, right? Because once you're forgiven, you need to promise to do something to repair the damage that was caused by your actions. And from there, reconciliation happens. And that's the whole process.
Can I throw a spanner in the works? And if there's any question, take it, please. Here's what becomes a lot of challenges with our dynamic societies as we move forward. There are some times where, let me talk on personal relationships. You find that, let me take my brother here, Israel. He's also a leader in Saljak. He's also one of the directors. Let me make an example. You find that your relationship with Israel is changing over time. And you are not aware why. Because Israel is not saying to you, Chris, you have offended me. Chris, you have hurt me. Chris, you have done that. You find that over time, the relationship has been damaged completely. Because one side knows what has been done wrong, but they do not come to the other side to explain what they did wrong. So as a result, there's broken relationship, and that is a prototype of our societies. A lot of people in our societies will tell you that kimone fela kwatile nakutwim latwaiki. And when I ask him, what do you say to that? When people have got issues and relationships are breaking, but people are not telling the others that this is what you have done. And at some point, the others who feel that they are being isolated make means and say, brother, sister, what wrong? I see that we are no longer on the same page where we used to be. Can we talk about it? If I'm wrong, tell me, I'll apologize. But on the other side, you get shut down. Ah, there's nothing. I'm fine. No, I'm fine. I'm shut. So as a result, the entire society gets affected and there's no harmony. Instead, divisions are going even to our children, our great-grandchildren, and it spreads. What would you say talking to them?
You see, the challenge that we find a lot is that people do not want to take responsibility for their actions, right? So you've made mention as an example between you and Israel. Mm. And your relationship drifts apart because you happen to be doing things that are wrong to Israel, but he's not coming to you and tell you, right? And you are not aware. You are not aware and you continue with the stuff, right? You continue with stuff. So now, who is being hurt? Let's say no one is being hurt in this case. Maybe Israel is being hurt, but he stays away. Why? Because probably at some point he came to relay a problem to you and he didn't want to listen. He didn't want to take responsibility. So he feels, you know what? Even if I go and confront a leadership board, nothing will come out of it. But at the same time, it worries you. Because you want that relationship to grow. You want the relationship to be to what it is. So I don't think there's anything wrong for you, leadership, to go to Israel and show him, Kore Morena, you know what? We've been doing coffee every day. You've been calling me first thing in the morning. I was the first person you remembered when you wake up in the morning. But now things are not happening. What is happening? You want a truthful answer. In that case, you become a victim of the circumstance. Mm. Although you may be the perpetrator, but the circumstance, because it's worrying you now, it's playing in your head. You become a victim of the circumstance. Things are not working, et cetera, et cetera. It's waking you. You have to go and confront him.
So you confront, you don't apologize.
You confront because you don't know what you're apologizing for.
The flip side is, let's go on the other side. Let's talk to Israel in this case. The guy who's not explaining what hurts him. I mean, these are dynamics we find in the society. People will say, "Nagi boni fela kwati, like it's iburi kete, hagi muta ure no kishab." So while we help men and women here to learn to build communities and societies, including our families, how do we talk to Israel now, who is not telling why he feels the way he does. And he has not spoken about his feelings before, that you are hating me. He's just quiet and he's drifting apart. How do we talk to those people? Because we also want to normalize people learning to listen to the other side of the story.
I think I've made mention of Matthew 18, the, you know, that whole process, that if a brother has sinned against you, so you are the victim here, you can see the circumstance is not very well, right? You go to Israel, he says, no, Nagishab, right? So the Bible teaches us that then you get two or three other witnesses, you take them with you, and you say, you know what, I've spoken to this guy, I can see that our relationship is drifting apart. But he still says he's okay. We've been doing coffee 5 times a week and now nothing is happening. You may find that sometimes you are assuming that he's angry of your actions. Whereas Israel is preoccupied by other things. He now has a wife, he's married now, he can't spend time with you. The relationship has drifted. So when you go and apologize for what? For something that you don't even know, right? You go and you confront when he says, Mrena, you've done A, B, C, and E, that's when you can apologize. And then you can make amends. But it is key that we sit down and we need to learn to sit down. In the olden days, in the traditional courts and everything, people were sitting down as families. You would sit down and say, I see this relationship is not going very well compared to what it was the other time. And I don't know the reasons why. Probably could you tell me what are the reasons? And many times, the challenge that we have many times is that we are using the why question. And why question makes people to be defensive, right? Whereas we need to use the what question. What question opens up a discussion? And then how question opens up a discussion. How can we repair this damage? What caused this damage to be where it is? Many times we say, why is this like this? And then people become defensive. So we need to check, especially, how we ask the questions. Let's move away from the why question and start asking the what and how. And what and how opens up. This person feels that, you know what, you are not threatening him and you care about him. It's not about you. It's about the relationship that is, we're seeing it being broken. And then they can open up to you.
Okay. Great stuff. Thank you, Brother Chris. Leaders, any question? Anybody who wants to have a bite at it? Please help me, guys, to pick up any questions. If there's any question here. Yeah, Mwetapelke, I want to hand this up now. There's no one who's talking, so let's give you the opportunity again.
Israel,
thank you very much, my leader. Actually, this one I made sure that I wait for no hand so that I can just. It's out of interest, more especially for my leader, Mr. Chris Denga, who's doing a very marvelous work in prisons and all that. So I don't know if it's just my opinion or from where I'm sitting, maybe the lenses I'm wearing. With regard to the programs for offenders as compared to victims, will I be entirely wrong if I say I think more energy is channeled to offenders other than the victims, because I think they always have to or mostly have to be the ones reaching out, but then the offenders are easily reached to. I don't know. It's just I just need your opinion or your comment when coming to that. I don't know if I maybe might be wrong because I think these are the sentiments I'm sharing with a few people as I engage with them with regard to these issues of victims and offenders kind of issues.
Yeah. I think what happens with the department, can I respond?
Yes.
Yeah. I think with regard to the victim offender dialogue. What happens is that, life is very unfair, unfortunately, because of the constitution of the country, right? The rights being afforded to the offenders is very unfair to the victims. For instance, Do you know that once an offender is incarcerated, is given an effect of some sort, and once they are placed in a correctional center, they have access to a social worker. They have access to medical care. They have access to clothing. They have access to a roof. They have access to education. They have access to all these other things, right? Which the victims do not get. So it becomes very unfair to people who have been wronged, because now they're saying these guys are getting it and we are not getting anything, whereas we are victims and we've been victimized and a lot of things have been taken from us. That is why, hence, therefore, we have the Restorative Justice Sycamore Tree program, which is Justice and Peace. Justice and Peace is geared to empower the victim. What happens is that when we are busy with the offender, there's another team that goes and prepares the victim. So we prepare the offender inside prison so that when they then ultimately get to meet for the victim-offender dialogue, the victim as well must have been prepared. They must be ready. And it's not a one-side thing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deng. I think you have answered me. I see there's a hand there by Reverend Moloi. If maybe my leader, you can go on it.
Good afternoon, leaders. My question is, I understand that my brother, Pastor Chris, or Pastor Denge, it's my focus, it's on general now, because I understand he's mainly focusing on the issues from the prison. But now I've got an uncle who it's an example, who has been bad, or he has done bad things to me, and I have decided to forgive him because it start with me. It doesn't matter what happens to him, but it start with me. I have forgiven him, but he's still within the vicinity. And forgiveness comes with peace, but I don't have peace. How do I deal with that? Because I have forgiven him, but he is still within my vicinity and I don't have that peace. How do I deal with it? Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much for the question. It is very difficult. Remember, it's difficult to forgive. A lot of people are saying, I will forgive them, but I don't want anything to do with them. Unfortunately, they are with us here. You are going to meet them. They are going to be within your space. You can't chase them away. So you got to deal deeply with that hurt. If needs be, probably engage your uncle, engage him further and say, I've forgiven you, but still, you know, there is this something, because you still have questions and there are questions that are still lacking. Hence, therefore, as a victim, you may forgive, but there's still something that's still lacking. So the answer to that, it would be, Hori, you need to confront him. You need to sit down with him and share your feelings. Share your feelings with other people as well, within the family. Pray, share your feelings with the brethren and let them pray with you so that you can get the peace that surpasses all understanding. You know, that peace that says, even when he moves around and he's successful and or he's not successful, you are able to go in and assist him. You know, the forgiveness that, I mean, remember when Jesus was going through the cross and he was able to say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. So you need to get to that point where you submit everything to Christ. I mean, we are told in Philippians 4, it says, don't worry about anything, but through prayer supplications with thanksgiving, submit all to God. And it further says that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your heart and your mind. Remember, it's an issue of the heart and the mind. So you need the peace of God that would want you to do the impossible and embrace the uncle who have hurt you, whom you say you have forgiven, but you still don't have that peace. Ask for the peace from the Lord.
Good response. Nadim Loy, did you get the answer? Oh, he says, thank you very much, my leader. Yeah, then he got the answer. We've got a few minutes left for closure. I want to give those who, anybody wants to have a bite on it, we have basically exhausted our time. I don't see any hand coming up. I'm going to ask Metapeli Chris if he can just give us a closing remark on this lecture in both forgiving and both receiving appeal for forgiveness, as in both sides of the coin. If you can just give us a closing remark.
My closing remark would be that forgiveness is tough. We do not have the power to forgive. We can never, otherwise if we have, then we become a God, right? So we need to ask for God's forgiveness so that we are able to extend it to the people that have wronged us. At the same time as well, when people come to us and they're apologetic about what we, you know, what they have done to us, we ask the questions and we get the truthful answers from them, the reasons those things happened, what happened, and then also how do we move forward? And then by asking how do we move forward, you are now looking at reconciliation. So you ask the what happened, and then what's the future holding? How do we move forward? And together with the perpetrator, you hold hands and you move forward. It's not going to be easy.
I want to go back slightly before we close to Tavayanda Demloi. Do you, once you are forgiven, are you forced to reconcile? I know you read a scripture that almost says that, but can I just get it as a closing remark? Once you have reconciled, once we have forgiven someone, they come to you and they say, we're asking for forgiveness, we have seen our faults, whatever. In order to have your own peace, are you forced to reconcile, or can you say, I've forgiven you for everything, but let's live apart so that there's peace and harmony in my life and in my heart? Can we do that?
Remember what I said before, let me re-emphasize this as well as a last closing remark, is that reconciliation does not lead to forgiveness. But forgiveness is a step towards reconciliation. So forgiveness is not reconciliation. So you are not forced to be reconciled to the person who has hurt you before. It's a step towards that. Mm.
Great stuff. Thank you very much, leadership. Thank you for all the leaders. And thank you for those who are also on Facebook as we're streaming live there, who have also, I see a lot of thanks here, even from the Tim Loy as well, from Date Israel and a few others. Thank you very much for your time and thank you for everybody. Brother Kish, this is Saljak, a home for all men. Please don't just come here once and go away. This is family. We need you here. We need Bonta Tim Loy here. We need every man here to put this structure together, to move forward as a nation so that we develop a new man, or we change a man that we have into the man of God, into the man who's going to be a leader in our communities and home. And thank you very much for the hard work that you are doing, and hope to see you again in Saljak. This is the beginning of the new relationship with you and everyone else who's here. And thank you very much and have a great evening.
Thank you, sir. It's all a pleasure. God bless.
Thank you. God bless you, Metapeli. Thank you, gents. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, ladies who are watching.